What's up, guys? This is Mike, the Detroit Borg, and we finally get a look at the Galaxy S8 and S8 Plus. So we're going to go in-depth and explore all the features of the new phones. Now, the boxes do include some specs along the back, and we're going to slide the boxes out of their sleeves so we can crack into them. So first up, we're going to start with the GS8, and as soon as you open up the box, you can see that's lined in this blue color, very similar, again, to the previous packaging. Now, the great thing here is that every phone, no matter what color you get, has a black front bezel. So I think this works best with the edge-to-edge display or infinity display. Now, the version I have here is Arctic Silver. Of course, you can get this in a few other colors, including black and orchid gray. Arctic Silver has this very distinctive mirror-like finish, and I really like this, especially with the way it works with the polished aluminum bezels. But of course, if you want the sleekest look, definitely go for black. Now, before we get to the big version of this, let's get to the accessories, and they're the same for both. So first up, we have a packet that also contains a SIM or SD card ejection tool along the back. Inside, we'll find lots of paperwork which might be specific to the carrier version you buy. At the bottom of the box, you'll find a ton of accessories very neatly packaged, including some new ones we haven't seen with the GS series before. But the thing that stands out right away is that all of these accessories are black, a welcome change. So the first accessories we have is the USB-C adapter. So we have two styles here that you can use. And of course, it's very handy to have, especially in a transitional period when many devices, including Samsung accessories, are still using micro USB. We also get Samsung's adaptive fast charging, which is also a standard spec built into USB-C here. So again, you can quickly recharge the internal battery on these phones. Lifting the cover, we'll find two additional accessories, including our black USB Type-C cable. But more interestingly here is the AKG headphones. So Samsung says that these sell independently for $100 and they come with your phone. Now, the great thing here is that these are really high quality headphones and they sound fantastic. They do include an inline remote control and microphone, as well as replacement ear gels to find the right fit. In terms of the overall style, they look a lot like traditional in-ear style headphones, so nothing really remarkable here, but one of the great things is that we have a rope style cable, so it should be a bit more durable than standard headphones. So moving on to the GS8 Plus, again, the only difference here is size. Everything else is otherwise identical, including the color I chose, Arctic Silver. Of course, all of the accessories are the same. The only difference is a spacer at the bottom of the box. Now, essentially, the design of these phones start with the displays. So we have two sizes here, 5.8 inch and 6.2 inch. Both of them have the same resolution, 1440 by 2960. And that's also called a Quad HD Plus display, and that's because it's extra tall. So we have the same narrow grip thanks to the curved edges, but it's extra tall to fill up the space that was normally occupied by just blank bezel space. Now, both of these phones have the same resolution, so the smaller phone gets a higher pixel count, 570 versus 529, but either way, they're really sharp displays. And once again, these are Super AMOLED displays, so that comes with stunningly bright colors and deep blacks. And this is also an extra bright display, so this looks fantastic outdoors. Even in direct sunlight, the display is clearly visible. Of course, a very legitimate concern is what happens when you grip the phone and touch the display, especially with rounded corners on both models, so you really can't get away from it now. Well, Samsung has really tweaked the performance of edge rejection. So when you grip the phone, it knows better. It knows not to act upon that grip as opposed to an intentional touch of the display. And for the most part, during my entire review period, it has been excellent. I've had no complaints. So they have improved the software enough to the point I think it's a non-issue. Now, if you pay close attention to the corners, you also see that the display is rounded to reflect the rounded edges of the phone, which looks really sharp. Now, like many other mobile devices this year, this phone also supports HDR. So with HDR, you can take advantage of the OLED display to its maximum potential with those bright, vivid colors and deep blacks. In terms of aspect ratio, this is 18.5 by 9, so that's actually a bit wider than the LG G6, so you have a few more pixels at the top and bottom. But of course, in terms of watching 16 by 9 video, this means you'll see black bars at either side, but Samsung does build in a software accommodation for video, so you can tap an icon that will allow the video to be expanded out to fill up the entire screen. Of course, this means you're cropping the top and bottom. Either way, I can comfortably say that this is the best looking display I've ever seen on a smartphone. Now, with this new design, the home button has been relocated to the screen, just like other Android phones. But unlike other Android phones, we actually get a physical click when you force press on the button. This is actually very similar to Touch ID with the taptic feedback you get when you press the button, which sort of replicates a physical click. And it does feel pretty similar to a button click, although it's not quite as localized as Touch ID. The only problem with this approach is is that the fingerprint sensor is no longer on the front, it's on the back, right beside the camera, which is in a pretty inconvenient location, especially for the larger S8 Plus. Now, to get around the placement of the fingerprint sensor, we have two biometric sensors added to this phone. We have iris scanning, which we're familiar with from the Note 7, and face detection, which is a pretty old technology we've seen for a number of years, but Samsung seems to have perfected it. Now, face detection obviously is not as secure because you can use a picture to unlock your phone. Now, for me, face detection definitely didn't work as reliably, and there wasn't sufficient feedback to tell me what was going on when it was scanning my face, so I'd like to see them improve that. And after using this phone for about a week, I don't think there is any substitute for a properly located fingerprint scanner. It's just a lot faster and more reliable. Now, crammed at the top edge of this phone is a lot, including a much smaller earpiece, although it doesn't seem to affect audio quality. It sounds just as good or even better than the earpiece from the previous model, despite looking much smaller. But overall, you can see they probably shrunk the earpiece down to fit all of the sensors and cameras it needed at the top of the phone. So it includes an 8-megapixel front-facing camera with autofocusing. That's the first time I've seen that on a smartphone. We also have a secondary infrared camera for iris scanning and the infrared light on the other side. There's also an LED notification light, an ambient light sensor, and a proximity sensor. So again, a lot of stuff built into the top edge of this phone for such a thin bezel. The other big feature addition with this phone is Bixby, which actually gets its own dedicated button along the left side right below the volume controls. So this is not to be confused with a power button, which is still along the right side. Now, for the most part, Bixby is underdeveloped right now, but it's their alternative to Google Now or Google Assistant. It's a smart voice assistant, but currently the voice feature is not activated. We're going to take a look at that when we go through the software. Along the top edge, we'll find our combination nano SIM tray and micro SD card slot. Now, this is a waterproof device, so if you pull that tray out, you'll see that there's a seal around it to keep water out of the port. Along the bottom edge, for the first time on the Galaxy S series phone, is a USB-C connector. And this really opens up a lot of possibilities, which now includes a DeX dock, which allows you to turn this phone into a desktop computer. And that's thanks to USB-C, and we're going to take a look at that when I get that in for review. We also have a headphone jack, so that has remained, and we get another mono speaker, which is waterproof. This does sound better than the speaker from the last model, but it still has this weird robotic sound, especially with voices, but it is louder and clearer, and I definitely don't have as many complaints about this speaker as I did before, but it would be nice if this combined with the earpiece for a stereo speaker system like some other phones have done recently. A dual speaker setup would also solve the other problem here, which is that it's just really easy to accidentally cover up the speaker when you're handling the phone.
Samsung updated its with this tablet is that we're now down to a 9.7-inch model. The 8-inch is gone. We also have an S Pen included with the box and all the technology needed to make that work.
Speaking of water resistance, this is an IP68 certified phone, which means it's waterproof up to 1.5 meters at 30 minutes, so that's pretty impressive. Now, because we have this all-glass phone, we do have wireless charging built in, which once again supports fast charging in addition to both Qi charging standards and PowerMat. Now, when it comes to the spec sheet, it does get a little complicated just because there's different CPUs sold in different regions, but in the US and the versions I have here, we get the Snapdragon 835, which is combined with the Adreno 540 GPU. In other parts of the world, you might get the Exynos 8895 octa-core 10 nanometer processor, which is combined with the Mali G71 MP20 GPU. But either way, we get 4 gigs of RAM with 64 gigs of internal storage. So because we go from a quad-core to an octa-core CPU, we see big gains here in terms of multi-core performance. Single-core performance is up just slightly. We also get a nice jump in terms of our graphics performance. So when it comes to day-to-day performance, for the most part, Samsung has really done a good job optimizing its version of Android recently. And that really is the same story here with the GS8. It's smooth and reliable, and it really had no complaints in terms of speed. There are occasions when sometimes it looks like it's hanging up or freezing. A lot of that does clear up after a moment. I think it's doing some RAM management in the background to fix that. But for the most part, I really have no issue in terms of performance and no complaints overall. The GS8 is also the first phone to come with Bluetooth 5.0, and with Bluetooth 5.0, we have much better range and bandwidth. The range goes all the way up to 800 feet, which is more than enough to cover an entire property through walls and floors and more, But we also get more bandwidth for multiple connections, so you can connect to two speakers at once. Or you can connect a set of headphones and a speaker and broadcast audio to both devices simultaneously. Now the camera back here has been improved slightly from the previous model. We have very similar specs. It's 12 megapixels, f1.7 aperture, so really nice wide aperture, along with optical image stabilization and 4K video recording. This is more flush than the last generation, so we virtually have no camera bump along the back, just a bezel that keeps the glass from making contact when you lay the phone down. Although the camera specs are mostly the same, we do get a new generation of Sony sensor built in, which does improve overall performance, but the real performance gains comes down to the image processing. So it now combines multiple images to optimize every image that you take. Also returning once again right next to the camera is a built-in heart rate monitor and an LED flash, but this time it's actually mounted underneath the glass for a more seamless design. So when it comes to camera quality, just like Samsung Display, Samsung cameras are some of the best you can buy on any smartphone today, and the results always speak for themselves. This is a great camera to use. It finds focus very quickly and accurately, has a very nice shallow depth of field, so shots look very dramatic and professional, so it's able to find the subject in the right spot, blur the background, and you can do that all without any special effects. It happens within the camera. And of course, shots look extremely well exposed, very crisp and clear. It's just a great camera to use in any lighting conditions. So it works great in low light as well because we have that f1.7 aperture, which lets plenty of light in. And we have fantastic image processing, so things look very clear without being over sharpened or noisy and grainy. I do find that this camera has a tendency to overexpose, so it tends to blow out some colors and highlights in some shots. The only thing I would like to see improved here is low light responsiveness, so the shutter seems to stay open a bit too long, so it's hard to get clear shots if there is any motion at all in low light. In terms of shooting video on this phone, Samsung makes it really easy, so this camera is really responsive. One of the great things about Samsung phones is that we have really smooth continuous autofocusing, so it finds focus very accurately and quickly without hunting around, and it's not noticeable while recording video. The other thing is that we have really good optical image stabilization, so handheld video looks fantastic. Now, if you want software stabilization as well, you'll have to drop down to a lower resolution because software stabilization is not available with Ultra HD. Now, for the most part, I really like the 4K footage that comes out of this camera, but there's a few issues that are worth pointing out. One of them is that exposure likes to jump around a bit, so you may want to lock that in place. The other issue is that the bit rate with 4K on this phone is pretty low, so you'll see a lot of MPEG compression noise. That's pretty typical for 4K on smartphones just because most smartphones can't really handle the full bit rate that 4K demands without some compromise. So if you want the best 4K performance out of this camera, you're going to have to download a third-party app to get you a higher bit rate. So when it comes to choosing between the Galaxy S8 and the S8 Plus, it really comes down to three factors. We get a larger display, a larger battery, and a bigger price with the S8 Plus. But that's the only difference. We have the same features, the same software, and the same design. So I think for most people, the Galaxy S8 is the right size, while the S8 Plus is pushing it just because the display is so tall. So with the S8, the fingerprint sensor is also much easier to reach. Even if you have big hands, the S8 Plus is still quite a stretch. But for me, the most important factor here is that you do get better battery life with the S8 Plus because we have a 3500 milliamp hour battery versus 3000 in the S8. So for me, the S8 Plus was able to get easily 6 hours of screen on time with high performance mode enabled. And that gets me through a full day of use. The S8, on the other hand, should deliver a little less than 5 hours of on-screen time under the same conditions. So when it comes to this front-facing camera, this is a new one here. This is 8 megapixels with autofocusing. So it's keeping track of my face, and you can tap anywhere on the screen to manually adjust focus and exposure as well. So it's a really nice camera. Also great audio pickup, so you can hear me clearly. So when it comes to using this fingerprint sensor, unless you have big hands like I do, it's kind of a reach here. So even for me, it's still a reach because I have to reach across the camera to touch that. And you really have to land it accurately. So you really have to look at it, or you just have to sort of fumble around until you get it. And it does respond pretty quickly when you land it, although sometimes it can be hit or miss. So digging into the software experience, of course, there's a lot new going on with a Samsung phone in addition to a lot of features we're pretty familiar with. So we're going to go in depth to explore how things have changed and what this phone offers. Now, in terms of the always-on display, this keeps getting more powerful with more features, and of course, it's really nice looking on this Infinity OLED display. So you can see this wallpaper in the background, which is actually related to the wallpaper you set on the lock screen and the home screen. Now, this does move around so it doesn't burn in, but it's always showing me my current date and time as well as my current notifications. Now, as you can see, I have these notification badges just below the clock, and I can double tap on these to access them, but of course, I'll have to authenticate. Now, in this case, I have the iris scanner set up, so it's actually automatically bringing that up, but because I have a camera on my face, that's not going to work too well, so I'm just going to use the fingerprint sensor. There's a few other features with this always-on display, so if I double tap on the clock widget, I can actually cycle between my clock and my media controls, which is handy. Now, when it comes to using this home button, it works somewhat similar to Touch ID, so when you force press on the screen right there, it actually vibrates with some haptic feedback. So if you press in, it vibrates once. When you release it, it vibrates again. Now, this works whether on the lock screen or the home screen, so when you force touch on it, you get a different, more intense vibration than just a light tap. So obviously, a big feature for this phone is Bixby because it gets its own button on the side. So that means this is a feature they really want to highlight, even though it's very immature right now. Now, it's not terribly unfamiliar. This is a feature that aggregates a lot of information in one spot and also offers information you weren't expecting, sort of like Google Now. So you'll see things like your schedule or your calendar events, upcoming reminders and weather information. You'll see news items and social media feeds and much more. And all of that is plugged in here by other apps, and you can modify that under settings. So we can change the Hello Bixby cards. So these are all the apps that contribute to Bixby. So if you want to turn some of them off, you can. So you'll see things like Samsung Health for fitness tracking, Samsung Internet, which is the browser, Samsung Themes, and more. So all of this stuff, if you don't want it appearing in your Bixby feed, you can turn it off. So right now, it's all on by default. Now, you can also access Bixby by swiping to the right. So you don't necessarily need a dedicated button, but it's always there. So when the device is locked, just press the Bixby button, and it takes you directly to the Bixby interface. Now, since Bixby gets its own button, there really is no need for it to be on the home screen. So if you want to turn this off, just pinch in and out, swipe to Bixby, turn that off, and it's gone. But you can still access it by hitting the button along the side. Now, when it comes to managing these home screens, again, we can long press or pinch in and out to activate the editor. So I can go ahead and rearrange these pages if I want, or I can assign different pages to be the home screen by tapping the home icon just above it. But we also have a few things here which are unique, which is the ability to reorganize the apps on the page, which is very handy. They've also spruced up the way we can manage the apps on the home screen. So if I tap and hold on an item here, you can see it starts to wiggle or jump up and down. And then we have all these options just below it. So we can remove the shortcut, clear the badge, so that will remove the badge notifications, put the app to sleep, uninstall the app, or just go to app info. But we also have this selection tool. So this allows us to select multiple apps. And if we do so, we can go ahead and create a folder, remove the shortcut so it goes back to the app drawer, or you can uninstall them if you can uninstall them. Now, to get to the app drawer, you swipe up or swipe down anywhere on the home screen. No matter where you are, you bring up the same interface. This interface also includes universal search, so it's one way of quickly accessing this feature, which I use a lot, so I'm glad to see this design change. I think it makes a lot of sense. So for example, I can see my suggested apps, but if I do a search for music or something else, you'll see related items in these cards down below based on their type of content. So of course, we'll see applications, gallery items, Google Play Music, My Files, and more. Of course, you can also just do a web search. Alternatively, you can also filter this down to specific items, so you can see the type of item you're looking for and limit to a specific time. Now, getting to this app drawer, you can see my instinct right away is to scroll up and down, but of course, that just hides the app drawer. Instead, you scroll left and right through the pages. Now, the app drawer has many features we're pretty familiar with, so we can folder our items, and of course, you can change the color, name, and you can add apps from a list, so it makes it very simple. Now, if you remember, in order to organize these apps, you used to have to go to the organize mode, but that's no longer necessary. All you have to do is drag and drop the items around in the app drawer, and you can folder them or just reposition them, but if you want to take them to the home screen, you just drag it to the top, which makes perfect sense to me. Now, diving into the settings, there's a few other things to take a look at here, such as home screen layout. So by default, home and app screen was activated, but if I choose home screen only, this gets rid of the app screen, or the app drawer as I call it. So if I click apply here, we're going to click apply and cross our fingers. So that eliminates the app drawer. Instead, we have universal search. So the apps are all loaded on our home screen now. There's a few other options here under home screen settings, such as home screen grid, so we can space these apps out a bit more if you want. So you have 4x5, 4x6, or 5x5, which is what I'm going to leave it at. And then you can also change the app screen grid from 5x6 to 4x6 if you prefer. But more importantly, if you're a fan of the apps button, you can restore that. So click apply here, and if you go back to the home screen now, we have an apps button, which is nice. Now for those apps you can't uninstall or don't want to uninstall, you can simply hide them. So we get a whole list of apps we can hide here, so I can hide some of the T-Mobile apps like so and click apply. So once I click apply, those are hidden from view and I can go back here to restore them if I want. So next up, I want to dig into the latest version of the Edge screen. So this is available for both the GS8 and the GS8 Plus, and you can see that you get this little handle along the side that allows you to swipe across it to access these features. Now this works whether you're on the home screen or within an app, so this gives you quick access to features like your favorite contacts or your favorite apps. And of course, there's a few other features in here you can turn on and off. And now this is highly customizable, so if we go to settings, we can actually customize the location of the handle and the size of it. We'll just have to go up to settings and go to handle settings, and this allows us to switch between the left hand or right hand side, and you can reposition this as well. We can also change how big it is or the transparency, so if you want to basically make it invisible, you can. We also have a vibration, so when you touch this, this will vibrate to let you know you've activated the feature. Now in terms of these Edge screen panels, we can select which ones we want to turn on, and there's quite a few of them, but if we don't see something we want, we can go ahead and download even more of them. And for the most part, they're free, but there's a few paid ones that are appearing more recently. Now for the ones that you can edit, you'll see these edit icons just below them. So for example, with the apps Edge, I can edit the apps that appear here. I can even folder some of the apps, which is handy. So if you wanna pack in the apps on the app screen, you can do that. Same with the people Edge, so you can edit the people that appear here as well. Now you can also rearrange these. You just tap and hold until you get to this reorder screen, and you can move them around like so. Now one of the new Edge screens is called Smart Select, which brings some screen grab tools from the Note series of devices to this device, which is kind of handy. So for example, we can take a rectangular screen grab. Basically, we resize this window to take a screen grab of just part of a shot. Another tool here is animation, so we can generate a GIF out of a video. So we get this little window, we can resize, so we can resize it to this window here, and then we can change the image quality, whether we want normal or high quality, and start recording it. And this will record up to 15 seconds, or you can stop it if you want. And when you do so, this will generate a GIF automatically. So you can see the animation right now. Another handy tool is pin to top. So we can go ahead and take a screen grab. So we're going to pick that, and this will pin that to the top of whatever we're doing. So for example, if we're writing an email or something like that, we can jump to another app here and refer to that. So it's not going to be hidden behind an app. So that's kind of a useful feature. And if you don't want it, just tap on it, close it out. Now when it comes to these Android navigation keys, of course we can tap and hold to get to our Google Assistant, which works exactly as we would expect it to. Now when it comes to multi-windowing, they've added a lot of features here, and there's a lot to take a look at. In terms of how you activate it, you can do this a number of ways, so we're going to go to the recent apps launcher. So for the apps that support it, you'll see these little icons next to the close button, which tells us that we can open up this app side by side. So I can open up YouTube on one side and Chrome on the other. So I can resize them, and you'll see that the window highlighted in blue is currently the active window. So if I hit the back button, this will navigate back within this app and not the one at the top. But if I tap on it, you can see that that app is now highlighted in blue. Now that's important when you tap on the divider, because this gives us tools for interacting with these windows. So I can switch between the top and the bottom like so. I can also close the app highlighted in blue, or I can window that app. So if I window that app, I get this little pop-out that allows me to move it around and resize it. I can also enter a badge view by tapping the icon here, or I can bring it forward again, or I can just go back to the home screen here. Automatically kicks it into this badge view, and I can pop it out again. So we've seen this feature before. We can tap on the maximize icon to bring it full screen. We can also enter multi-windowing mode by tapping and holding on the recent apps button while we're within an app, and that app is minimized to the top of the screen, and we can select something else. And we're not limited to just apps that are currently open. We can go to more apps, and for apps that are compatible with this, we can go ahead and open them up side by side. Now when you're looking at windows side by side and you leave for the home screen, this will actually minimize those side by side apps, and you'll see that icon has changed, indicating that we're currently in multi-window mode. So this basically means I can leave what I was doing and find another app I want to load. So for example, if I just go to, let's see, the email app. This will open up the email app down below and retain the app toward the top. And again, I can leave this again and go open up something else such as the Google app. So that opens up the Google app down below, retains the app toward the top. And if you want to leave this, just tap and hold, and that closes out the app toward the bottom. Now, there are a few multi-window features which are turned off by default, and you have to go to Settings and under Advanced Features, you have to go to Multi-Window Mode to turn some of these on, which includes the pop-up view action. So if you turn this on within certain apps, you can actually swipe in from the corner to get this pop-up view, which can be moved around, resized like so, or you can minimize it into a badge view, bring it back forward, or maximize the window. And this works with up to 5 apps at a time. So for example, I can launch into the internet browser here, swipe, and then I can reposition and move it around. Now, if I hit the home button, these automatically collapse down into these icons. And this time, they're all grouped together in one location, so they're not floating around the entire screen, which is nice. So I can move this around and expand it out to open up the apps I want. You can also remove these by tapping and holding and taking them up to remove, and it closes both of them out. Now, there's another tool baked into the recent apps viewer that might be useful, and that is this option to select only part of an app. And that only appears on the first app within the recent apps viewer. So, for example, I can go to Chrome here, and if I go to recent apps, you'll see that tool now appears there. So, this is especially useful for YouTube. So, if I go to YouTube here and select this tool, I can basically crop part of this app. So, for example, if I just want to see the video part of this, we're going to select that and click done. So now if I select another app to open up side by side, such as Chrome, all I see toward the top is exactly what I want to see, which is the video, nothing else. Swiping to our notification shade, this is Android 7, so for the most part, it does have many of those same features, such as the expandable notifications. We do have block notifications down here, which takes us directly to our notification settings. So you can turn off notifications for certain apps or jump to more settings. But as always, there are tons of quick settings up top, and these are customizable. So one of the things I don't like is that the brightness slider is not accessible from this quick gesture here. So you can see I have the first 6 settings up top, but the brightness slider requires you to drag it down again. So you can modify this. All I have to do is go to the drop down and show the control on top. So once I do that, if I click done here now and I swipe up, you can see that's always at the top, which I think is more convenient. In terms of this brightness slider, if you slide it all the way to the right, you get this red zone, which just tells you that the extra bright display is more fatiguing on the eye and zaps your battery. So it just discourages you from using that. But getting to these quick setting toggles, there are 2 pages here, and you can modify the arrangement so we can go for a different grid. 4x3 is default, but if you want 5x3 for a denser view, you have that option as well. Now, there are a lot of buttons up here, and many of them are not necessary. So if you want to rearrange them, just go to button order, and then we get this interface for dragging and dropping the buttons around. And if you want to remove some of them, just drag and drop to the blank space area, and that removes it from view. Now, one of the new settings buttons is performance mode. So if we turn this on, this is kind of the opposite of battery saving mode. So this maximizes performance, increases the brightness of the display, and makes sure it's running at the highest resolution. And we can click apply. So this is actually what I've been using the device in to maximize its performance. Alternatively, of course, we have power saving, which will turn off high performance mode. So you can see exactly what this is going to do, and there's tons of customization options, and we can click apply here. So obviously that's going to turn off our high performance mode. Now, if I tap and hold on this, I'm going to show you exactly what you can do down here. So there are tons of features. So we have medium mode. So if we click on mid, you can see exactly all the things it's going to do. So it's going to reduce the CPU performance, background network usage, screen brightness, as well as resolution. You can customize this as well. So you can customize how this behaves in medium mode. So if you don't want it to reduce the screen resolution, you can go ahead and turn that off. Or if you want to decrease the screen's brightness or improve the CPU performance, all that is highly customizable here. Of course, we also have maximum mode. So we've seen this before. It used to be called ultra power saving mode, I believe. So if we click apply, this significantly reduces the performance of the device, reduces the brightness, the colors, the background processing, CPU performance, the apps that you can launch, and more. So there we go. We get a mostly black screen, a few essential apps, and of course, we have our notifications and some quick settings up top. We also have a blue light filter, which looks pretty good here. Now, you can customize this schedule, so we can change the intensity as well. So if you want really orange, you can go ahead and select that. You can set it to automatically kick in with sunset and sunrise, or customize the schedule. Edge lighting is another feature we can quickly toggle on and off or just tap and hold to take us directly to the settings panel. We've seen this feature before, but it's been enhanced with this latest version. Now, this lights up the edge of the screen when you receive notifications, and this works when the screen is locked or not. So that's an enhancement we haven't seen before. But basically, this is mostly useful when the phone is laying face down. So when you're receiving a phone call or a message, the edge of the screen lights up and sort of reflects on your table. Quick reply is also still here, so this works when the phone is face down and receiving a message or a phone call. All you have to do is tap the heart rate monitor, and this will send off a quick canned message. Smart View allows us to connect to other devices on our network, which we can cast media to, such as audio or video. So it automatically sees those devices on the network. Right now, it's just seeing my Google Cast devices on the network. But if I had a smart TV that supported Google Cast, you would see that here as well. And you can quickly broadcast the display and audio wirelessly to those devices. So next up, I want to dig into the settings interface. And as always, there's always tons of things to discover, especially with Samsung devices. So it's definitely worth digging through here. Bluetooth is obviously a big deal with this device, and we have some new software features for controlling this. But with Bluetooth 5.0, we can connect multiple sources at once. So right now I have two devices connected here, and I can go ahead and connect to both of them simultaneously. So that means I can play media on both of those speakers. Now for the most part, that just means that each one is streaming its own source, so they're not really working together. So there can be some delay and reverb. So it doesn't sound great next to each other, but if you take the speakers in separate rooms, it sounds just fine. Now, when it comes to separate app sound, this allows us to assign a speaker to an app. So that means instead of connecting the entire device to a Bluetooth speaker in which all the audio is streamed to that Bluetooth speaker, this instead allows us to separate the audio from a specific app to broadcast only on that Bluetooth speaker. For example, if I select YouTube, you can select any app you want, we can assign that to Bluetooth only. So that means when I'm playing a YouTube video, the audio is going to a Bluetooth speaker, but the speaker on the device is free for everything else. And if you're connected to Bluetooth devices playing audio, you'll get this little control up here within the drop-down shade, which makes it pretty easy to switch audio sources. So you can see which device you're currently connected to, and you have some of your settings here, and you also have your audio output, so you can select a different source. That different source also includes dual audio, and you can enable that right from the settings panel. Now you can highly customize the interface here as well by going to the display settings panel. So in addition to all of our brightness settings, we do have our screen mode, which includes some of our color profiles. Right now I'm using adaptive display, and when you're in that mode, you can also adjust the color balance if you want or just restore it to default. We have AMOLED Cinema and AMOLED Photo, or Basic if you prefer as well. Now, under full screen apps, this allows us to turn off the scaling of certain apps. So because we have an extra tall display, for the most part, most apps will automatically fit to the screen. Others give you the option to turn it on and off. So for example, I've turned off scaling for Chrome. Now, if I go to the Chrome app now, you'll see that it doesn't fill up the entire screen. So you'll see those black bars at the top and bottom. So if I want to restore that, I'm just going to jump back to settings here. And I can go ahead and enable it. So now if I go back to the app, you'll see that it is scaled to the entire screen. Of course, what Samsung phone doesn't have an easy mode, as I call it the grandma mode. So if we apply this, this will enlarge the icons, enlarge the text, and basically simplify the interface so it's a little more user-friendly. Now with icon frames, as you know, Samsung has done a really good job sort of unifying the design of its operating system. But that means applying frames to every app that you install, third-party apps. But of course, Samsung apps are properly scaled to this design. So if you want to turn that off, you can. So we're going to go with icons only, click done. So now if you go to the home screen here, you can see those apps have restored their basic icon design. Status bar also gets a new tweak here. So because we get a lot of notifications, as you can see up top, you can limit this to the most recent 3 notifications. And as you can see, you get a lot more space and it just looks more cleaned up. Now for the first time, a Samsung phone has a navigation bar, and we get some navigation bar settings, and they went all out here. So you can actually change the color of the navigation bar backgrounds. If you want gold to go with your gold phone or pink or what have you, you can go ahead and select it. I prefer white personally. We can also select a custom color. So if you just want to select something more vibrant, you can go ahead and do that. More importantly, you can actually change the button layout. Now we have 2 presets we can select from. It just switches the recent apps and back button. You can also increase the pressure sensitivity of the home button. I actually think it requires too much pressure, so I'm going to go ahead and select more sensitive. Now, for people who really like to customize their phones under wallpapers and themes, we'll find a one-stop location for all of that. So you can install your own icon packs, download entire themes, and more. Now, as you might have noticed already, the wallpapers respond with movement and motion on the display. And this effect here, called the infinity effect, is actually applied to the always-on display as well. So you'll see a blue stripe across the screen here and the infinity effect. But when it comes to themes, you can download pretty elaborate packs. Many of them are paid, some of them are free, but usually they're pretty cheap. And you can select separate icon packs or AODs. So AODs are basically wallpapers for the always-on display. Advanced Features has a ton of things going on. Many of them are pretty familiar for Samsung devices, such as Smart Stay, which keeps track of your eyes and keeps the display on or puts it to sleep if you're looking at it. We have one-handed mode. So this is off by default, but one-handed mode can be activated by swiping in from the left or right corner. And I can toggle between the left or right corner by tapping this arrow or just tap the blank space to restore back to normal. A really cool new feature is the finger sensor gesture. So this is on by default, but if you tap on this explains exactly what happens here. But basically, all I have to do is swipe across on the sensor to bring down the notification shade. We've seen this on other devices before. We can also quickly launch the camera by double pressing the power key, and that works whether the device is locked or not. Taking a look at some of these other tools, we have Smart Capture. So this explains exactly how this works, but this works best with a website. So if I do a screen grab here, I have another feature that allows me to do a scroll capture. So this allows me to continue scroll capturing an entire website until I'm satisfied here. And so you'll see that build along the right side. That's a very useful feature and I use it quite a bit. We can also palm swipe to capture, but I find that causes more problems than it's worth, so I usually like to use the buttons. We also have direct call. So direct call is a feature we've seen for a number of years. So if you're looking at a message or a contact, soon as you lift up the phone, it dials them automatically. Smart alert basically vibrates when you lift up the phone, so it lets you know that there's a new notification to take a look at. We also have easy mute. So if your phone is ringing, just palm the device or place it face down to mute the call. We also have swipe to call or send a message. So again, if you're looking at a contact, just swipe left or right to either send them a message or call them right away. We can also send an SOS message. We've seen this for a while, so if we turn this on, we'll actually have to agree to all these terms and conditions. And we'll have to add an emergency contact that acts as our SOS contact. So if I quickly press the power key 3 times, this will send pictures from both of the cameras and send a 5-second audio recording along with my GPS location. So if you don't know that's there, you won't be able to use that unless you set it up. So that's good to know. We also have Video Enhancer. We've seen this for a few years, but basically this enhances the video quality of certain apps like YouTube or basically any of the video apps to improve the video output. Device maintenance is sort of a one-stop location for managing the system resources for this device and checking out its critical functions. Of course, this is where we'll find our battery info. So you'll see your battery usage and you can activate one of the power saving modes. We also have our CPU performance. So right now I'm in performance mode, but I have several other modes I can select from. And normally, by default, it's in the optimized mode, which is what I would normally be using. But during the course of this review, I've decided to use high performance to get the best out of this phone. Of course, we also have game and entertainment performance. You can see exactly what those modes will do to the device. In terms of storage, you can see how much storage I'm currently using, and I can clean up storage automatically. We also have our memory usage. So you can see how much memory I'm currently using, and you can clean this up right now by closing down some of those background apps. Now, digging into the camera app, it launches really quickly. That's something Samsung is really good at. Now, the camera app does integrate Bixby, so you'll see a button dedicated to that. So this basically scans whatever you're looking at and does a search. Now, this can do a location search, an item search, or whatever, and you'll see it automatically generate items down below. So it sees images and shopping items that might be related here. So if I tap on images, so it did a search, and it looks like it wasn't specific enough. So what I'm going to do is go back here, and I'm going to resize this box for that specific item and see what it comes up with now. And there we go. So it found it. So next up, if I do shopping, let's see if it finds that item. And indeed, it did find related items, but not the exact item. Now, in terms of the camera interface, they have made some significant changes here. So I can now use the shutter release as a zoom button, which is actually really useful. I actually really like that feature. Of course, you can also tap anywhere on the shot to adjust exposure and focus or do so manually with this controller on the screen. Snap a photograph, and if you tap and hold on the shutter release, takes a burst shot, which is pretty fast. In terms of recording video here, it records video and I can pinch in and out to zoom Tap anywhere for exposure and focus, and of course it does have full AF. Of course, you can also snap photographs while recording, pause it, or resume it. We also have a few other buttons that appear on the screen, which allows us to soften skin tones for a more flattering look. Of course, that works best with people in the shot. And then you can actually apply effects, and there's a few of them we can pick from here. So we can apply these facial effects. I'm going to do this with the front-facing camera, but if you had people in your shot, this would automatically track their face and apply these effects here, and there's quite a few of them. We also have these indicators, which tells us that if we swipe to the left, we'll see all of our filters, which also includes all of the effects we can apply. And then we can also swipe to the right to get to our modes, and we have a few of them preloaded. The biggest one here is Pro Mode. So with Pro Mode, we can manually adjust many of our values, such as our focus, white balance, exposure, and ISO. Now you can rearrange these, so if you want to move them around like so, and then you can also go to Edit to remove the ones you don't want, or you can actually add new ones from the App Store. So it includes things like animated GIF, beauty face, and many of the features we've seen preloaded on previous phones. You can also add a shortcut to a specific mode on the home screen. So if you want the Pro Mode on the home screen, we're going to go ahead and select that, click Done. We should see that right there. It launches directly into the Pro Camera Mode. In terms of our settings, we have a few things to take a look at, such as our picture size. So you can see I've cropped it to 9.1 megapixels to get a full 16:9 aspect ratio. You can see our video size, which does include QHD, the native resolution sort of this display, along with Ultra HD, which is what I've been shooting in. We do have tracking autofocusing, which you can enable, shape correction, so this will fix distortion in pictures automatically. In terms of the front camera, we do get QHD, which we've seen for a while, so again, that's a nice feature to have for the front-facing camera. Also hidden under here is motion photo, which is a little like live photo, so it takes a brief video clip alongside a photograph. We also have voice control, which means we can use a few voice commands to operate the camera, which is very handy. We've seen this for a while with Samsung. Something I haven't seen before is the floating camera button, so let's go check that out. So there we go, we have our floating camera button, which means we can reposition it to anywhere on the screen to take a photograph. We can also talk to it. Cheese. Record video. Now to switch between the rear-facing and front-facing camera, just swipe across on the screen. And this is the first front-facing camera I've ever used that actually has AF. And as you can see, the camera zooms in and out as it finds focus on my face. Now if you swipe to the left, just like on the front-facing camera, you get to all of these effects and filters. And the one I want to take a look at here are the face effects. So you can apply animations just like you would within Snapchat or Instagram. There's quite a selection of them, and some of them actually get sound effects. So if I find the right one here, let me go ahead and select this one. So you can see it applies the effect in real time. I can even eat my cupcake here, but let's go find one with sound effects, like so. Oh boy, okay. Let's find another one here. Okay.
So in the end, the Galaxy S8 really doesn't disappoint. It's unlike anything else you can buy right now, with a stunning display, a great camera system, and a ton of new features that really advance the smartphone, from iris scanning to facial recognition to Bluetooth 5.0 and more. But of course, like anything else, it's not perfect. The location of the fingerprint sensor could be better, and so could the speaker quality. But all things considered, they've done a really good job releasing a very polished product with a lot of design challenges built into it. Alrighty guys, I just want to thank you for watching this very long video. If you guys enjoyed it, please let me know with a like, and I'll see you again in my next video.